We also have as one of our speakers is Michael Williams. Michael is opposing Senator Jack Murphy, District 27 here in Forsyth County. And we're going to just let him speak for a few minutes and then we'll take any questions.
I don't think, you guys can hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right, I don't think any of my microphone. But thank you, Trilby, and thank you, Bob, for the invite. And also, thank you, Mike. I learned a lot. And one thing I just want to add to that is state sovereignty is a very important topic to me. And one of the reasons I think we've lost our state sovereignty is money. A topic that our state budget, and we hear numbers thrown around about $18 or $19 billion. Our state actually spends closer to $40 billion. And where does that extra money come from? It comes from the federal government. So we're selling our sovereignty as a state to our federal government. So that's something that needs to be addressed as well. So thank you for your comments. I also want to thank my beautiful wife, Virginia. She is a rock in my life. Before we decided for me to run for state senate, we talked long and hard about the challenges and obstacles that it would pose. And she's been there with me, and I'm very grateful for her support. I also want to thank all of you guys for this great community we have here in Forsyth County. I first moved here in 2003. My youngest daughter, Courtney, she actually was just born. She wasn't even a month old. She had three older brothers. Kent, who was 13. Ammon, I forgot his name for a second. Ammon, who was 5, and Jared, who was 3. They're now 23, and Kent graduated from North Forsyth High School here, obviously here in the county. And all three of them go to Forsyth County Public Schools. Ammon, again, the 15-year-old, he loves to wrestle. He's been wrestling ever since he was 7 years old. And Coach Jerome at North Forsyth has a really good wrestling program, and he's a big active in it and part of that. Courtney and Jared, they love to play softball and baseball. And ever since they were 5, they've been involved in some of the little leagues with baseball and softball and all that. And again, that's because it's a great community that we have here in Forsyth County. So I thank you guys for all of that. A little bit about myself. I wasn't raised wanting to be in politics. My passion has always been business. In fact, when I was 10 years old, I started my very first business. It was kind of a makeshift convenience store. Had an old bookshelf in my room. I went down to the local store, bought a bunch of candies and Cokes, packed up my backpack, took it on the bus. That was pretty much my marketplace. And I was selling candy and Cokes on the bus, making a pretty good profit for a 10-year-old. Well, word got out about this to the local school. And they had their own little candy sales going on there. And they didn't like me cutting into their profits. So they shut me down. That was my first interaction with government. I wish I could say that was my last negative interaction. Unfortunately, there's been 3 other instances in my life where our government has made it difficult for me to make a living and provide for my family. The very first time, I just graduated from college with an accounting degree, and I got my CPA exam. I went to work with Arthur Anderson. At one point, it was the largest and most prestigious accounting and audit firm in the entire world. They had the unlikely or the unlucky task of being the auditors for Enron. We all know about the Enron debacle. There was a massive outcry and public, you know, they wanted something done. So our government, instead of going after the true culprits of that fraud, they went after Arthur Anderson, and they shut us down. 85,000 people lost their jobs. I was one of those 85,000 people. We bounced back about 2 years later. I bought into a franchise called Sport Clips Haircuts. My entire family, my mom, my dad, well, not my dad, but my mom, my brothers, my sisters, my aunts, cousins, they're all entrepreneurs. So even though I was the youngest franchisee in Sport Clips, it was a very natural fit for me. I actually became one of the largest franchisees of the company. Within about 3 years, I had 11 locations. And I had plans to grow even bigger. I had banks lined up to back me up. I had leases out there ready to expand. Anybody here had a good year in 2008? Oh, I did. All these obligations, these commitments I'd made to expand my business, all the banks withheld their money. Even though they'd made commitments to me, they said we couldn't do it anymore. Again, what did our government do? Instead of helping out the little guys like you and me, they go out and they give out billions of dollars to other large companies. Some of these companies were even the people that instituted the collapse. So that was the second time. Several years down the road, you know, we're struggling through this. We finally get to it. It actually brought me almost to the point of collapse, of financial collapse. We struggled through it. We grew the business despite everything going on. We got to 18 locations, about 160 employees. Things started going well, and the 30 been happening. Anybody here ever heard of Obamacare?
Yes.
160 employees, very, very labor-intensive business. Our profit margins couldn't substantiate the excess cost associated with Obamacare. So we sold the business back in May. Whenever you're talking about John Hancock, now we took it personal. This is very personal to me. You know, I would definitely sign with a large pen stroke. So that's what kind of brings me here. That's why I'm standing here before you today, asking for your guys' support and for your vote. It's because I, for one, am fed up with a large government, with abusive government that's going in and taking away our liberties and our rights. And as I prepared for these talks and these speeches, I've kind of thought back in my mind of all the talks I've heard other political candidates and that kind of stuff. And to be quite frankly, none of them ever really got me excited, except for Ronald Reagan. I remember as a kid, laying on the couch on the floor watching Ronald Reagan speak with my dad. So as I prepared this, I didn't want to come across contrived or fake or fraud or anything like that. So what I thought I'd do, instead of telling you everything I think is wrong with the government, because we all know there's lots of problems, what I'm going to do is tell you the three guiding principles that I'm going to use that's going to help me make decisions. The first one is accountability. We have very little accountability in our society. My wife and I, we were at a county fair not too long ago, and it was a beautiful fair, it was great weather. The people of the fair had this little trolley system, these little golf carts that would take you from your car to the park. And we were riding one back, and there was this family about five. It was a mom and dad and three kids. And the kids wanted to ride in the very back of this golf cart. Well, back there's not any seat belts, not any safety devices to keep the kids on board. The parents knew this, and they still allowed their kids to sit back there. They asked their kids, please hold on to mom or dad or the rail or whatnot. Luckily, nothing happened. They made it back to their car okay. Had something happened, and one of those kids got hurt by falling off, we all know what would have happened. They would have sued, the fair. Mm-hmm. Now, they wanted to push the accountability off onto somebody else instead of them taking accountability for their own actions. We as a society have accepted that. And I personally think it's wrong. But one of the reasons I think we're there as a society is because our elected officials, they keep kicking the can down the road. They want to blame everybody else. And they've created this environment, both within our legal system and our judicial system, that allows us to push our responsibility onto somebody else. It's time that stops. It's time that we hold our elected officials accountable for the things that they do. This past legislative session, there was a law that was passed. Some people said it was massive or great ethics reform. What it really is they set a limit to what lobbyists can give an elected official. Where's the accountability in that, though? Who's responsible for making sure that happens? It's not put on the elected official. It's placed on the lobbyist. If a lobbyist can come to me, if I become elected, give me $10,000. If I don't report that, I might get a small little fine. That lobbyist could go to jail or be impacted with massive fines. That's not accountability to me. Accountability is making it responsible, my responsibility to do it, and if I don't do it, there's punishments, real severe consequences. The second one is I believe in people. I believe that people are naturally good and kind-hearted. Whether or not you agree with the government shutdown or not, I feel like a very important, I guess, fact emerged from that. And what that is whenever people are truly in need, whenever there's a need that people truly have, instead of just a handout, we as citizens of this great country will come together and provide. Throughout the country, citizens came together and helped out other citizens that were affected by the government shutdown. One of the most touching ones to me was that of a fallen soldier. The family, because the government shutdown, did not receive the death benefits that were entitled to them. Word got out about this, and I believe it was, I can't remember the name of the charity. I apologize, it slips my mind. But the charity came in and provided the funds necessary for that soldier to be brought home to its family. Time and time again, we see this happening, whether it's hurricanes or tornadoes or natural disasters. We, the people, step in and provide for those that are needed. We don't need the government in there making it more difficult for us to do that.
But they had plenty of money to spy on his family.
Exactly, yeah. Yes, yeah. But I believe in people, not necessarily government. I feel like they just need to kind of get out of our way. Lastly is, I believe in truth. That's not something that we hear very often from our elected officials, politicians. One of the more prevalent ones right now was our beloved president saying that you can keep your insurance, you can keep your doctors. That was as much a lie as it was spoken as it is today. Something else kind of more close to home was T-SPLOST. You know, we were told by our elected officials they wouldn't raise taxes on us. So what did they do? They gave us an opportunity to raise taxes on ourselves. That's not being very truthful to me. Whether or not, you know, we need better roads, I agree with 100%. I believe that we need to be able to sit down and have an honest debate about that. Something that I heard from another politician, I can't really take credit for it, is that the biggest deficit that we face in our country isn't the national debt or budget deficits, it's the deficits that we have of trust between our elected officials and its citizens. I want to change that. That's one of my personal goals, is that whether or not you agree with me or you disagree with me, I want to be able to stand before you and tell you what I really think, what's really going on. So you don't have no political spin, nothing like that. It's just you and me having an honest, true conversation. Because as we all know, there's lots of problems in our country right now, but we can't address them, we can't get them fixed unless we can start that honest and true debate. So that's a little bit about me, about what I stand for and represent. And I appreciate you guys listening to me. And any questions you might have for me or the other Mike, I welcome them.